Greetings once again, my Cherryful Chariots. Today's video will be structured differently than how I usually structure my videos. There won't be a story-driven intro this time around. Instead, it will be more so me ranting about my experiences with Netflix's newest anime, Castlevania Nocturne. This will be a spoiler-heavy review from a very passionate fan of the franchise, so I will lay out my thoughts based on what I believe could have been implemented better or just flat out didn't need to be added. Also, the way this rant will be structured is that I will talk about the characters instead of just going based on episodes, as I believe it doesn't allow me to speak coherently about flaws I see within a character. Trust me, this will be very much understood when we get to a certain character in this video. So relax, grab some popcorn, have a glass of wine ready, because we are going into the world of Castlevania Nocturne. The first character I wanted to cover in this section was none other than Richter Belmont, the main character of the show. Upon watching the entire season in one sitting, I can say with certainty that I had no issue with how Richter was portrayed. In fact, I can say for sure that I enjoyed him as a character, and I wanted to know what was going on with him at all times. Sure, at times the voice of the character didn't quite portray the emotions that were supposed to be delivered, but I think it's either the animation not syncing well with the emotions the actor is portraying, or the actor not portraying the emotion needed for the scene. Either way, his voice work is decent at the very least. It feels off at times, but other than those times, it works excellently. I enjoyed the symbolism that the bandana around his head is meant to symbolize, but it was nothing too granular. Richter felt like the main character. He didn't feel like Trevor, where we were just following an asshole around for certain parts of the show and just moved on to more enticing characters.
That is better than sex.
Richter, within his own right, was interesting. His lows in the show can definitely be explained because we see why he acts the way that he does. The trauma given to him by seeing his mother die, potentially at his own hands? Seriously, Child Richter was a darn idiot. But I believe this season handles his character well. It never felt like he got sidelined for some minor character plot. Overall, I think his interpretation is fine. The next character I don't really have a lot to talk about, so I'll try to keep it short. Maria in this show, I'm a little mixed on. On the one hand, she is the Maria that we expect her to be. In other ways though, she makes some very crucial and not so smart decisions. However, she isn't a complete asshole. There are many times within the show she is sympathetic to other characters and their struggles and shows visible distress upon seeing those characters that she cared about being turned into night creatures. Like how that one revolutionary character named Jacques, you know, the guy with the orange hair, he got killed off pretty early into the show. I think it was episode 1 or 2 that he got killed off. And it wasn't really for anything either, it was just for, I guess, shock value, or I guess so they can do something with him later, but I don't know, I just feel like it really wasn't needed. Other than that though, they didn't change her magic or abilities all too much. However, I have noticed that her water serpent named Seriu, I probably butchered that, but he's gone. But I suppose we shall wait for season 2 if that creature ever shows up again. Overall though, I don't dislike Maria in the show. In all actuality really, I enjoy the time we get to see her being focused on, or have her be the main focus. I think the alterations made around her character are actually pretty cool, as we never really got to see Maria's parents before, and they're never really talked about in the games all too much. So it's nice to see that they are able to rewrite it in a way where certain characters could fit the role of Maria's mother and father. Speaking of which... Alright, you can execute me on the spot for all I care, but I believe that Tera and Emmanuel's drama is so good. I think that these two characters are pivotal to the story's engagement and entertainment. I had no problem turning Tera into Maria's mother. Absolutely none. The whole drama behind the Renard family is juicy as ever living fuck. The most dramatic and most tense moments happen with them in it. I love Emmanuel as a character. In fact, I think he's my favorite character in the entire show thus far. He believes that what he is doing is right, but he knows deep down that it's not, and it pains him each and every second to do what he is doing. But he must do it for the protection and safety of humanity, for his wife, for his daughter. He's a very emotionally driven character, and that I'm glad did not die by the end of the season. I would have loved and craved to see more of Emmanuel if the show were to receive a second season. As for Tera, have any of you played Draculex Chronicles? Well, if you have, then you know exactly what I think is going to happen to Tera next season. Overall, I love each of these two characters. Motivation-wise, the designs, the voices, the stories, everything. I always loved plots surrounding the church. Speaking of the church... Now, there are things that have to be addressed. One of these things is the plot between Olrox and Mizrak.
What the actual
Okay, if you wanted to pick a gay character, that is fine. Everyone already thinks Isaac from Curse of Darkness is gayer than the rainbow itself. It's fine, I have no issue with it. But in Nocturne, I feel like the love plot between Olrox is overplayed. I think if the scene with Olrox where he was sitting naked in bed with Mizrak was either removed or simply changed to fit a better circumstance or setting, I wouldn't have reacted the way I did when I first viewed it. In fact, there is no implication that Olrox was playing for the same team, up until that episode where Olrox first meets Mizrak at the church. Oh come on, you can't tell me that this scene right here wasn't with the two of them pinning each other against the wall didn't scream zesty to any of you. Also, either Drolta or Erzsebeth made this comment, but apparently Olrox is meant to be Aztec? No, I don't believe so. His design more so reflects tribes from the Great Plains or Southeast regions of the United States, if anything. Hell, if you really want to stretch it, you can say it has some Southwest or Eastern Woodlands influence, but not Aztec. Aztecs, from many historical points, have been known to be more advanced than most, if not very advanced, compared to the tribes in the Americas. Not to say that those other tribes weren't advanced or anything, but compared to the Aztecs, they had more groundwork to work on for grand societies and structures that many of these tribes just didn't have. So if looks are meant to be anything, Olrox isn't likely to be from the Mexican Peninsula. Granted, I could be wrong. Sure, I'm open to the idea. Perhaps Drolta just said it as a demeaning joke towards Olrox. Shit if I know, it's hard to say. But other than that one scene and that one comment made by Drolta, I like Olrox's character. I mean, it's not like I can say I prefer the Symphony of the Night version, considering that there really isn't anything to pick or piece together at to begin with. So, also, Olrox scars the ever-living shit out of Richter the next time we see him. The intent here is to portray how scary and intimidating Olrox is, but it's hard to put that image together when the last time we saw him was when he was getting happy-go-lucky with Mizrak. Speaking of who, Mizrak is an alright character. I have no beef with him. In fact, I argue he's one of the few characters that gets decent character development by the end of the season. However, I can name one character who did not have that. Now, let's start off on a positive note, shall we? As a character, Eduoard is a very... complex. Yeah, let's go with that. I like his design, and his voice acting is pretty peak in episode 3, but holy shit is his character wasted after that. All because of a certain character not knowing when the fuck to go behind a certain bush. Yeah, I do not like Annette. At all. It doesn't help that we are meant to feel sympathetic for her due to episode 3 delving into her past. But holy shit, does she disregard everyone like a dickhead. When Richter runs out of the church's underground due to gay native vampire showing up, not only does Annette absolutely call him a pussy and a coward, but the characters are written in a way to suggest that we are supposed to believe what she is saying is right. Like, excuse me? Everyone was nothing but sympathetic to you after you were crying like a bitch over Eduoard, but as soon as someone else goes through trauma, you call them a coward and proceed to not forgive them until conveniently they come to you and apologize, when out of all people who should be apologizing is you. Not only were you the only person in the party to suggest to rush the chateau without a fucking plan, which ended up in Eduoard being killed and turned into a night creature, but on top of that, you wanted to rush back into the church to save Eduoard after figuring out that he was there. Are you fucking serious? Richter can't kill Olrox, but Annette can conveniently kill her master by surrounding him in crosses. Yeah, okay. Also, unrelated, but why the fuck did Maria need to cross the bridge Annette made when later on we see her summon Genbu later on to cross a stream? Huh? Also, we have seen vampires turn into bats and fly towards the fucking eclipse? But you want me to believe that they can't fly over a damn river? Returning back to Annette though, the only reason why she was race-swapped was so that they can push to the message that slavery is bad and we want freedom. More so the freedom part, but slavery is bad part is definitely there. As if I, a vampire, needed to be told about human morals. Nah shit, slavery is bad. We live in a society that is fully aware of that, so it baffles me that the writers and artists thought it was necessary to change everything about Annette just so they can push a message that everyone already understands. Oh, and did you know that Annette supposedly has feelings for Richter, and Richter has feelings for her? Bro, fucking how? Literally, all Annette has done has been mostly be a bitch to you behind your fucking back and talk shit about you to your own fucking family, when all you did was react rationally to seeing your trauma. How do you have feelings for her? If anything, it would make more sense if Annette was in love with Eduoard, which is very much implied. Overall, Annette is the Amber of Castlevania. Not only is she, oh my god, she's a mess. She's not completely horrible. There are moments where I have cared. But dear lord, does she do and say some of the dumbest shit in the entire show, and if you ask me, she is irredeemable. Now, let's move on to other characters before I get even more flippant. God, I despise these two. It's like rewatching the third and fourth seasons of the original anime where Carmilla's just a big bad and acts like an insufferable wanker for the entirety of those two seasons. Drolta acts more like Carmilla if anything, so at least in some aspects, Erzsebeth is somewhat better, as she has the authority to talk shit, but Drolta is just, dear Christ, just understand that I do not like any moment she was on screen. Also, I was genuinely shocked that Dregla has nothing to do with this show. My theory at the beginning was that Erzsebeth was going to pull an Aria of Sorrow and start an eclipse in order to bring back Dracula, but it seems that my theory was completely wrong. Instead, what she was going to do was start an eclipse in order to reign an eternal night. You know, perhaps someone should have told her about the ebony stone. Anyway, Erzsebeth isn't completely awful per se, I just simply don't like her. Similar to how many people probably say that Walter Bernhardt isn't too awful, but they just don't like him. Even though I'm in the minority that clearly disagrees, that is besides the point. All I can end this on is that I'm glad that Drolta got oofed at the very final moments of the last episode by Alucard. That is one less Carmilla-like character that I have to deal with. My boy is fucking here! The rumors were fucking true! My love is in the damn show, he's in the damn show, he's in the damn show, he's in the show, he's in the show, he's in the show, he's in the show! Sorry everyone for my awful singing, but My, I can't resist when it's about Juiced. I had my suspicions about Juiced being in the anime before it actually came out, but if you were to watch the anime with me, in every episode, without fail, I would start chanting randomly during a scene where I thought Juiced would show up. Juiced, 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 Juiced. But when episode 5 came out and showed us Juiced, I fucking cried my heart out. At that moment in time, Nocturne became my favorite anime of all time. Each and every second Juiced was on screen, I cherished it. I'm so glad that they chose not to kill him off, because if they did, well, expect a very angry letter. As to his betrayal though, he is an old warrior character, the supposed wise one, so to say. He himself states that he was the best magician the Belmont line had ever seen up to that point, and if you ask me, I still think it holds true. He also states though that he lost his magic that one fateful day, and it led to the deaths of his wife, Lydie, and his friend, Maxim, which to this day I'm still upset about, and I will ignore that line ever existed.
But it happened though. He literally said it.
It never happened.
I think it was a missed opportunity though, to not animate a flashback sequence with young Juiced with Maxim and Lydie and all the sort, but I'm just glad to get a Juiced that isn't dead. I also wish that they had him wear his iconic red cloak instead of just the clothes he wore underneath. It's obvious that Juice holds a lot of regret and resentment towards himself for the past and wish that things were different, you know? Also, one gripe I have about the Juiced and Richter scene when they get restrained by the hunters that are vampires is that Richter seems to gain magic out of nowhere for just simply thinking about Tera, Maria, and for some reason Annette. Meanwhile, the expert magician, who has been learning and honing his magic since youth, can't do a single spell and can't regain his power, which I call bullshit. Julius in Dawn of Sorrow was 56. Juiced here is 62. It is said that he lost his magic a good few moons ago. So you mean to tell me that a 56-year-old Julius can retain his magic perfectly fine, but Juiced, at probably near the same age, just loses his magic for no reason? Okay, yeah, cool. Nerf him, why don't you? He's one of the most powerful Belmonts in the entire series. Yeah, just nerf him. I hope that Juiced accompanies Richter and everyone to fight against Erzsebeth in the second season, if there is gonna be one, after he relearns all of his magic and realizes that there is more purpose to life than what he says there is. There is no way that after seeing Richter learn magic, he isn't inspired to take up a sword or a whip and use magic to help his grandchild that he says he cares about. Well, action-wise, it's debatable whether or not he cares. If Juiced would be to accompany them, it would be cool as shit if Juiced got to meet Alucard. The only named Belmonts besides Juiced in this situation if he were to see Alucard who have not seen Alucard at all or even met him are Leon, Christopher, Solil, Victor if he's canon, and all the residents from that one village in Order of Ecclesia. If you don't think that's true, fact check me on it. To see one of the most magically powerful Belmonts in the series meet Alucard would be a dream come fucking true. All I'm saying is that you have Juiced Belmont. Don't waste him. Overall, I think the anime is a decent watch. Trust me, it could have definitely been worse. So the fact that it showed up the way that it was, it's fine. It has some high highs and some very low lows. I had a decent experience with the show itself. I think many of the ideas that were brought in are good, while others are either questionable or just flat out unnecessary or poorly implemented. I can say with confidence that this anime is by no means an adaptation of Rondo of Blood or Symphony of the Night, due to how many drastic story changes are made. To call it an adaptation of those two stories is a bit dishonest. Rather, I think the term that fits this is either a retelling or a fanfiction that takes iconic characters and places them in different scenarios than the original, with new characters brought into the mix. Also, if you are expecting good music to come out of the show, I both laugh at you and pity you. The only semi-decent song in the show is the one that was all over the trailers for it, that being Divine Bloodlines. Hooray! One of the most overplayed songs in Castlevania is the only decent one in the show. Yay! The animation quality is still as good as ever, but I believe they focus too much on the battle scenes, as this time around the characters sometimes look like they are just standing stiffly, almost like animatronics. But I shall end with this. What were your thoughts and reactions to the season 1 of this anime? Were they like mine or were they different? Do let me know, and recall that I do read every single comment, because as a vampire I have nothing else better to do. Regardless, my name is Sarissa Valentine, and stay cheerful on this cursed night.